size you can get. It's an honor system. There's a basket back there for your money. If you want to buy a t-shirt, just drop it back in there and grab a t-shirt. Right, and what Brother Ben said, for next Sunday is our signature Sunday, so we're going to wear these t-shirts next Sunday. So if you want to pay next week, grab a t-shirt, put the money in next week, okay? That will work. That's our signature Sunday for next week. You have your bulletins in front of you. We do not want to alarm you, but just pay attention to the Tulakes financial summary down there on the bottom left. Our general funds balance as of right now is $371. You know, we had the ice storm about 4 weeks ago when we missed a Sunday, so us missing a Sunday is really a challenge for us. So please pray about it. If you're able to give more, or you're able to give some, or if you are behind in your tithe, pray about it, and so that we can get caught back up so we can continue to pay our bills and keep the lights on. So let's pray about that. Let's see. Today, before and after the services, we said that. Thursday, May 9th, Singing Church Women Concert, Quail Springs Baptist Church. They were here last year. You guys remember, for those of you that came. Our church capacity is like 300, and we had about 325 people in here, and it was crowded. But it was awfully wonderful. Stacy Baker, fundraiser, liver transplant recipient. May 18th, 11:30 to 2:00. There's an article down there. Please read that and just be aware of that if that's something you want to do, if you want to feel the conviction for that. Signature Sunday, wear your Tulakes Baptist Church t-shirt. Yep. And May 12th, 2 weeks, is Mother's Day service, children's dedication ceremony. See Brother Ben for details if you want to get your child dedicated. Myra and I happen to know somebody. She's been here a few times. Tulu is bringing Nathan, and she's going to have him dedicated here at our church. She goes to Life Church. Is that where she goes? She goes to a different church, but we've been praying, just trying to get her into this one because this is what she needs. So she's agreed to come have him dedicated on Mother's Day, and you guys are just going to show enough love on her that she comes back the next day. Levi and Kissin are not here, so for an update on baby Sadie.
All right, so Levi texted me this morning. He's not here this morning because he's so tired. There's, I believe, contractions are about 2 hours apart, so they haven't been getting any sleep. But that means the baby is very close, probably within the next day or two, we think. So that's an update.
Wonderful, wonderful.
It's good stuff.
Okay.
Good stuff.
That's good stuff. So by this time next Sunday, baby Sadie should be here. All right, let's see. So you can now give your tithes and offerings via the church's PayPal account. You had the little flyer in the bulletin a couple weeks ago. You can donate through PayPal, so log in that way as well. It's just so important for us as a church family to be able to continue our tithing and our offerings the way that God wants us to do through our convictions. All right, so any other announcements before I turn this over? Anything else? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for what you do for us. Father God, we thank you for the joy of the sunshine this morning. Father, that it warms us on the outside at the same time that your spirit warms us on the in. Father, it is so awesome that we know that we worship the God of all. Father, we know that your son Jesus bridged the gap for us to be able to come back to you so we can spend eternity in heaven. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the sacrifice you made. We can never repay you, never fully understand what it is that you did, knowing what was coming. You still went through it, and you did it for us. Father, may we worship with all of our might this morning, all of our heart, all of our mind, all of our strength. May we be blessed for being here. Father, may we leave the service this morning, go out into the world this afternoon, tomorrow, the next day. May we be the light to those around us. Father, we ask you for your blessings. We ask you for your favor beyond your blessings, to help remind us in our own lives and in the words that we speak to be worthy and to always think, what would you do? Jesus, what would you want us to say? How would you want us to act? May we have the courage to do just that. Nothing more, nothing less, nothing else than you, Lord, in our daily life. In your holy and great name, we pray these things. Amen.
Amen. Welcome, everybody. It's good to see you here. Everybody watching on Facebook Live, it's wonderful that you're with us this morning. Go ahead and stand up. Let's sing. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, love endures forever. And for the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. From the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever.
Amen. I'm going to read something to you guys that I wrote, and we get to take a name off of the prayer list because of this. And I was talking to this track star behind me, Jared, earlier, and we believe that this is the result, that we believe that this young lady experienced a miracle from God. I want to share a story whereby most of us know the participants. She came to visit us a few times in the last year or so and was becoming friends with many of us. Her conviction was clear that she moved into a new realm and a lifelong career, so Judith signed up and joined the U.S. Air Force. She's that real short one, not much bigger than Norma, that would come, and she just lightened up our hearts. She faced the normal challenges one might expect with drill instructors yelling and marching, training of all types for all hours of the day and night, becoming disciplined. But she had one failing. Her shortness of height and her shorter stride meant she would face extra challenges to meet the minimum run time the military requires, which is a mile and a half in 16 minutes. The military doesn't care if you're this tall or this tall. If you are a female, you do that mile and a half in 16 minutes. Now, she's been on our prayer list. We here included her in our prayer list, and we made contact with her circle of friends, her family, her second church home. Judith is a strong Christian and knows the value of prayer, so she asked as many as would to lift her. Her testimony is found in Isaiah 40, 31. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. So remember that. She became ill the week before Easter and spent most of it on light duty and in bed with medicines. But she spent that Sunday, Easter Sunday, in prayer and worship, calling for favor and believing. She had failed her PT test that run. She had failed it four times in a row. Each week on a Monday, she would take that test. And she was down to her last chance. And it was on Good Monday. On Good Monday, she ran her final test, and her call to me on the 24th last week had one declaration. She couldn't explain it, but that fateful morning she arose, and with a renewed strength and unusual focus, she ran a full 65 seconds faster than she had ever run before. She ran her distance in 15 minutes and 55 seconds and passed. And passed. She did. And I was talking with Jared, and in order to cut your time on any event, he does the half mile. To be able to cut your time by such a significant amount with no training and the fact that she was sick for the week before, which meant she lost her strength, we know that was nothing short of a miracle from God. We all know God's miracles from the cancer that we've had and the challenges that a lot of us have as family, but this is an example where nothing is too insignificant to bring to God. Nothing. She brought that to God. So we know from Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, we have all been given every spiritual blessing under heaven and earth already, and we simply claim them by our belief and our witness. Judith did. And that was just, she wanted me to share that. Visitors, if this is the first time that you've been here today, please take a moment. This card should be in the chair in front of you. Fill it out, drop it in the offering plate so we have a record of your attendance. We also, as a church family, we have a memory verse that we say because we know that we live this and we believe this, and it can change us and it can help us with our days. So today is going to be a good day in the Southwest because we will. We'll do both of those, won't we? We will rejoice and be glad. All right, so how about we take a couple of minutes and say hello, or if we have any visitors, you guys look around you, go say hi to them. Remember our people that are infirm, not able to get around as much, so go shake hands with them as well. Let's meet and greet.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. See you. high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, 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 holy. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
See you high.
See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, 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 holy. I want to see you. All right, as you make your way back to your seats, we're going to sing Worthy of Worship. Worthy of worship, worthy of praise, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all the glad songs we can sing, worthy of all of the offerings we bring, you are worthy. Father, Creator, you are worthy. Savior, Sustainer, you are worthy. Worthy and wonderful, worthy of worship and praise. Worthy of reverence. Worthy of fear, worthy of love and devotion, worthy of bowing and bending of knees, worthy of all this and added to these, you are worthy. Father, Creator, you are worthy. Savior, Sustainer, you are worthy. Worthy and wonderful, worthy of worship and praise. Almighty Father, Master and Lord, King of all kings and Redeemer, Wonderful Counselor, Comforter, Friend, Savior and Source of all life without end, you are worthy. Father, Creator, you are worthy. Savior, Sustainer, you are worthy. Worthy and wonderful, worthy of worship and praise.
All right, so this next song is called This I Believe. If you've ever heard of the Apostles' Creed, it's a document that outlines basically the whole Christian faith, the basis of the Christian faith, and this song is based off of that. And it's something I've been learning in one of my classes this semester. I've had to memorize the creed, and like looking over it, it's like I believe a lot of these things, but am I actually doing all these things? And I just hope that you listen to the words carefully and if you don't believe, I pray that you soften your heart this morning. Father everlasting, be your creating one, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that He will come again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender, who's hurt and crucified, forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light, forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that He will come again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. In life eternal, I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Before creation,
you stood before creation, eternity in your hand. You spoke the earth into motion, my soul now to stand.
Just before my failure,
you stood before my failure, carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon your shoulders, my soul now to stand. What can I say? What can I do? But offer this heart, oh God, completely to you.
So I'll walk.
I'll walk upon salvation. shine. Spirit alive in me, my life to declare your promise, my soul now to stand.
What can I say?
I say, what can I do? Offer this heart, oh God, completely to you. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned, in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours. I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned, in awe one who gave it all. I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours. I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned, in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours. What can I say? What can I do? Offer this heart, oh God, completely to you.
Sing, so I'll stand.
So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned, in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours.
Sing it again.
I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned, in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours.
What can I say?
What can I say? What can I do? Offer this heart, oh God, completely to you.
Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning. We thank you so much that we're able to be here and we're able to worship you and praise your name. Father, it's almost May and this year's been going by pretty quick. I just want to pray that whatever stage in life we are at right now, individually, that you'll walk with us and be with us. You say that no matter what we're going through, you're always with us. You're walking right along there with us. So I pray for everyone who's going through something in here, because we know we all are. I pray that you continue to let us know that you're walking with us. Help us to stand with our arms high and our hearts abandoned, even though it hurts. even though we might not want to. We've been there. We've all been there. Father, we love you so much, and we know that we can't express the amount of love that you have for us. Just want to pray that you just continue to be with us in everything that we do, everywhere we go, whatever is happening. Pray for Brother Ben this morning that his message will be not his own, but from you, Lord, from your heart. And bless everybody for being here today. We love you so much. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. This is our time in our service where we take a few moments to come before God and pray. The altar is open up front if you'd like to come forward and pray. If there's anybody that needs some specific prayer this morning, you can lift your hand or stand up, and those around you will come and pray with you. And after a time of prayer, we'll have our offertory prayer. So let's take a few moments and pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you today just giving you thanks for this day. Lord, we just want to lift up those that cannot be here this morning for health reasons, for traveling, for expecting a new member to their family, whatever the case may be, Father. I just pray that you would watch over them and bless them. Lord, we just thank you that we can freely come here to worship. And Father, we lift up these tithes and offerings to you. Bless it and help us to know exactly what we need to be doing with it to further the work that you've called us to do here. Lord, we lift up Brother Ben to you here as he'll be delivering the words that you've laid on his heart. Father, I pray that we are prepared to receive it and to apply it where necessary. Lord, we love you and thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to me, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior. Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, oh, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, oh, how great.
Sing it together, we know the words. Here we go.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen. Thank you, Ben. Praise the Lord. Wow. I know that's a favorite of many of you. That's one of your favorite songs. And if you're glad you're saved this morning, would you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. I tell you what, I'm so glad. Sometimes, you know, you're just like, yes, I am saved. I am ready. I'm walking with the Lord, because we never know when that last day or hour will come. Our children are being dismissed to children's church. And we appreciate their being taught and getting to stay in here for the worship. I think that's really important. And you know, I do kind of remember, it was about the seventh grade before I began to really comprehend what the preacher was saying. I don't know. You know, up about, you know, first through sixth, I didn't go to kindergarten, all right. I'm deeply scarred because of that. But how many of you did not go to kindergarten? All right, yeah, the old school, I don't know. They didn't have that back then. Like, you're in first grade. And so I don't know. I don't even know where I'm going with all that, except anyway, but I'm glad that they're being taught and they're being able to comprehend on their level. Because, you know, after the preacher would say a bunch of hard words, I'm like, oh, well, I'm just going to, you know, fiddle around with my thumbs or color or something like that. This morning, we're going to continue to celebrate the resurrection by looking at one of his 10 post-resurrection appearances. And this is probably the most comprehensive resurrection appearance and post-resurrection appearance. And I was talking to somebody this week, and they go, oh, did that happen on the seashore where Jesus made breakfast for them? Did that happen after the resurrection? And it's like, yeah, that happened after the resurrection. And this is a really, in this 21st chapter of John, it's good because it kind of wraps up what happened to Peter. What happened to Peter after he denied the Lord three times? Did he ever get it back together? Well, the Lord restores him here. And so that we're going to read this, and it's going to help us to understand the risen Christ. And I think all of our lives, that's what we're trying to do. We're growing in our understanding of God, our understanding of Scripture, our knowledge of God. We're growing in that. The Bible commands us to grow in that. And I remember when I was first a young Christian, I thought, I don't understand any of this. You know what I mean? I'm just like, it's all so confusing. I don't even know the, you know, I hate it. I used to have a Sunday school teacher. He'd play tricks on us. Turn to First Hezekiah, he would say. Man, I'm looking for it. I'm looking. I don't know. I don't know all the books of the Bible. There are weird names in there. It's like, ha, that's not funny. So if you're a Sunday school teacher, don't do that to somebody. So everybody can. Hezekiah was in the Bible, though, you know. But we're going to understand some things about the risen Christ. I'm reminded, we've been watching a lot of shows about England. Jeannie and I, we like to, I think we watched Downton Abbey, and we've been watching Queen Victoria and things like that. And I was reading the other day about when Princess Mary was a little girl and her mother was Queen Charlotte, and she was trying to read this book and she just couldn't get it. She just couldn't get it. And she went to her mother with tears in her eyes and called her mother Madam and said, Madam, I cannot comprehend it. And her mother said, what you cannot comprehend today, perhaps you can comprehend tomorrow. And what you cannot attain to this year, you can arrive at the next. Very English, right? But what it means is that we can apply this to ourselves and our understanding of God and the Word of God. There's a lot of things that we cannot comprehend today. We don't understand some of the things that happen. And one of these days, we'll have complete understanding in that sweet by and by. But we grow in our understanding of what who God is and our walk with Him and the knowledge of Scripture. And so it's a process, and it's a never-ending process until we enter eternity, right? So we're never, you know, sometimes even people ask me, well, you've been to seminary and all of this, and you've read the Bible through and through and all of that, and they ask me a question. I say, I don't know. I don't know. We just don't know until we step into eternity. So let's go ahead and read the 21st chapter of the Gospel of John. And this is, he's the only one that records this. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias, which is the same as the Sea of Galilee. And in this way, he showed himself. Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of the disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them, I'm going fishing. They said to him, we are going with you also. They went out and immediately got into the boat, and that night they caught nothing. I'm going to pause here just a minute, and I'm just going to say, some commentators say that Peter was kind of backsliding. He was going back to his old life because he was a fisherman. I don't know if I buy that or not. I think that they had left Jerusalem. It was about a four-day trip up to Galilee. The Lord said he would appear to them in a mountain in Galilee. And I'm thinking they're waiting around for Jesus to appear, and I think he just says, let's go fishing. Now, that's my opinion. Some, John MacArthur says he thought he was kind of backsliding and maybe turning his back on the ministry. I don't really see that. They were waiting for Jesus to appear. And it's my own opinion, too, that I believe that Jesus, after this meeting, he told them when and where on what mountain he was going to meet them. Okay? But in the meantime, they needed some money. Let's go fishing and see what we can catch. Okay? All right, that night they caught nothing. But when the morning had now come, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Okay, he was about 100 yards away. Then Jesus said to them, children, have you any food? And they answered, no, the fish aren't biting, or whatever. We can't catch them with a net. And he said to them, cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. They probably looked at each other. It's worth a try. What can we lose? So they cast, and now they were not able to draw it in because of the multitude of fish. Therefore, the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, and that's John, it is the Lord. Now, when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he had removed it, and plunged into the sea. That just shows the impulsiveness of Peter, okay? That's just Peter. He just did things sometimes, and obviously he was a good swimmer, because some of us might not even make it for 100 yards to swim to shore. Also, you know why he knew it was the Lord? Because this is the same type of miracle that happened earlier in Luke 5. It's recorded. And Jesus said, set out and launch out into the deep for a catch. And they're going, oh, the fish, there's no fish. We can't catch them. And they did. They had a miraculous catch there too. Okay? But the other disciples came in the little boat, for they were not far from land, but about 200 cubits. And a cubit's a foot and a half, so 300 feet. Dragging the net with the fish. Then as soon as they had come to land, they saw a fire of coals there and fish laid on it and bread. Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish which you have just caught. Simon Peter went up and dragged the net to land full of large fish, 153. And although there were so many, the net was not broken. I will say that they were true fishermen. Because a fisherman, if they have a big catch, you want to know how big and how many, all right? And that's true. I know once when the sand bass were biting, I caught 105. I counted them. They were just biting about every time I threw in, and the 106th one broke my line, and I quit for the day, all right? Jesus said to them, come and eat breakfast. Yet none of the disciples dared ask him, who are you, knowing that it was the Lord? Jesus then came and took the bread and gave it to them, and likewise the fish. This is now the third time Jesus showed himself to his disciples, or I say the group of disciples, okay, after he was raised from the dead. So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to him, feed my lambs. He said to him again a second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said, tend my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Most assuredly, I say to you, when you were younger, you girded yourself and walked where you wished. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will gird you and carry you where you are not, where you do not wish. This he spoke, signifying by what death he would glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he said to him, follow me. By the way, Peter, it's not in the Bible, but extra biblical literature tells us that he was crucified under Nero's persecution, and he requested to be crucified upside down, because he was not worthy to be crucified in the same manner of his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Then Peter, turning around, they might have been walking along the beach, or along the sea, seashore. And then Peter, turning around, saw the disciple whom Jesus loved following, who also had leaned on his breast at the supper and said, Lord, who is the one who betrays you? Peter, seeing him, said to Jesus, but Lord, what about this man? Jesus said to him, if I will that he remain till I come, what is that to you? You follow me. Then this saying went out among the brethren that this disciple would not die. Yet Jesus did not say to him that he would not die, but if I will that he remain till I come, what is that to you? This is the disciple who testifies of these things and wrote these things, and we know that his testimony is true. And there are also many other things that Jesus did, which if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. Amen. So we know that in the Gospels, they just selected a few things Jesus ministered for 3.5 years, and there were so many things that there would have been volumes and volumes if we had a comprehensive, exhaustive list of everything that Jesus did. All right, join me in prayer. Father, we do thank you for your word. It is a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our path. Lord, this morning, help us to glean those nuggets that are in this passage and apply them to our lives. And most of all, Lord, I pray that we know that you are the resurrected Lord, and we have trusted in you as our own personal Savior. We know that if we were to breathe our very last breath today, that we would be with you in heaven forever and ever. And this I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. There's three, I know these were a lot of verses, but this is kind of one This is one scene. This is one take. This is one event that happens there on the Sea of Galilee. And I think it's good just to kind of put it all together. Put it all together. And the number one thing I want us to do is to understand the power of the risen Christ. Understanding the power of the risen Christ. And here's what we can learn from the, basically the first 11 verses where they were didn't catch anything and Jesus told them to throw the net. We can do nothing for the kingdom of God without the Lord's help. Amen? Obedience to His word brings success, and the Lord's power is released through cooperating and partnering with Him. That's what we do. The Lord allows us to partner and cooperate with Him as He builds the church. He said, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades or hell shall not prevail against it. And so we are cooperating with Him. We can do nothing. You know, they hadn't caught anything all night. And do you think that was probably the Lord's doing? I think it was. He was going to teach them a lesson. I mean, they could not. They were throwing the net, and they were doing everything that they knew to do, and they were not catching any fish. And I think He took away their self-confidence and their success to get their attention. You know, sometimes God has to take away our self-confidence and our success in order to get our attention to look at Him. Because when everything's going well, as we said in the 70s, when everything's groovy, you know, I mean, we don't really think about God. When the wheels start to fall off of everything and we go, wait, this isn't working, I'm failing, then we say, God, help us. We should be asking God to help us and be communing with the Lord, whether things are good or bad, whether it's we're living in the sunshine or on a cloudy day of rain. Amen? We should be, you know, looking to Him at all times. And John 15:5 says, Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. Nada. You can't do anything. Not anything lasting and eternal. It needs to go through Him, all right, or Him working through you for it to be of eternal significance. Otherwise, you're doing your own thing and you're not listening to the Lord. So He said, without me, you can do nothing. I also think it's important that, you know, success for the disciples was only a boat width away. I'm sure they looked at each other and said, what? Throw it on the other side? Like, okay, whatever. I don't know who this guy is. Is he your grandpa or something? I don't know. We'll throw it over here. And like, whoa, look at all the fish. Jesus was proving a point to them. Obedience brings success. And that means when we're obedient to the Lord, we walk in His favor. And that's why we need to not be led away by the tempter, because the devil is always tempting us and trying to get us to compromise and be like the world. And he's like, no, I want to live in God's favor, don't you? I want to be blessable. God wants to bless the blessable. And I know that when I dishonor Him, disobey Him, I'm really hurting myself. It's what I'm doing. I'm taking away, I'm giving Satan an advantage over me and taking away God's favor from my life. I don't want to do that. I want to walk in His favor. Some verses, John 14:15. If you love me, keep my commandments. And I know sometimes I've said, Lord, I do love you. And, you know, I have to, because temptation is real, right? Temptation is real to do the wrong thing. Sometimes we even want to do the wrong thing for the right reasons. I know that's crazy, okay? I want to feed my family. That's a good reason. I'm going to go rob this store. No, I'm going to go rip something off from somebody's backyard. No, good motive, but do the right thing to do to feed your family or whatever. 1 John 2:3-5. It's wrong in your bulletin. It should be chapter 2. Now, by this we know that we know Him if we keep His commandments. He who says, I know Him and does not keep His commandments is a liar and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps His word, truly the love of God is perfected in him. By this we know that we are in Him. And so John is saying that, you know, if we say, oh, I love God, and then we're just not obeying Him and disregarding Him, what the Scripture says, then you're living in denial, all right? the queen of denial, okay, or the king of denial. That's what you're doing. And so by this we know that we are in him. And also Luke 11:28, this is what Jesus said. But he said, more than that, blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it. And they were saying, man, your mother must be, Mary must be blessed. And he said, but more than that, blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it. And so when we really, he is our Lord, then he is our kurios. It means that we listen to him and we obey him, because that leads to life. By the way, sin is deceptive. Sin is always deceptive. It promises something it can't deliver. When I was a young Christian, I always said, it's like M&M's filled with cyanide. Oh, it looks really good. You get in and you get this really sweet taste, like, it's so good. And then, you're gone. Sin kills and then it thrills. Thrills and then it kills. Sin thrills, kind of, and then it kills. And so, I don't know if anyone ever thought of that. Next time you eat an M&M, think of that. But it's like, oh, it's really got that out, that sweet taste, that little shell that won't melt in your hand. And then in the inside, though, sin is death. And that's what happens. Somebody said once, the trouble with trouble is that a lot of times it starts out as fun. But, reminded that I remember in Lone Wolf. Some of you people might know Lone Wolf. Yeah, Lone Wolf. I remember a kid was there, and I heard about it the next day, and he was gunning his car, and he'd been drinking and everything, and everybody's laughing and all that, and he takes out down towards the railroad, and I don't remember what happened, but he was dead like in about 20 seconds from that, because, he was having fun. He was drinking and driving, and he was dead, It's like everybody was laughing, watching him do, donuts or whatever he was doing, and then he was dead in a matter of, very short time. So be careful, be wise, be wise. So understanding the power of the risen Christ, that we can do nothing for the kingdom of God without the Lord's help, obedience to his word brings success, and the Lord's power is released through cooperating with him. Jesus brought the fish to the boat, but the disciples had to throw the net. If the Lord wanted to, he could have just had the fish all jump into the boat. But that's the way he provides for us many times, is we cooperate. We cooperate with him. We cooperate with him in the ministry. The Lord works in people's hearts and lives, but we declare the good news of Jesus Christ, and they come to faith. That's the way he provides our needs also. We work, but he does what we cannot do. And 153 fish, there are so many theories about that. I read one about some make it prophetic, 150 days here, 53 days here. And one guy, it was just blowing my mind. He was doing the square root of 153 times three times. It was just this equation, like, who in the world would come up with that? Somebody I wrote down said, the Lord, they went through all the Bible about the particular people he healed and blessed. The Lord blessed 153 people in 48 separate incidents. I really don't know if there's any significance of that, except there was 153 big fish. And so that's interesting. I know there will always be many theories on what is there significance to that 153. Number two, understanding the provision of the risen Christ. When they come there, they find him there, and he has breakfast. Jesus said, come and eat breakfast. And yet none of his disciples dared to ask him, who are you? Because they knew who he was. And Jesus had some bread and some fish. He had a fire going there. But he said, bring some of your fish also. So understanding the provision, they came into the Lord's presence on the seashore. He is the source of every blessing and every provision. Okay, they were going to eat breakfast, but it's bigger than that. Jesus supplemented their catch with other fish. This was a lesson that applied to the disciples' future evangelical efforts, and their nets did not break as in the previous and similar incident recorded in Luke 5:5-6. That must have fallen off the bottom there. But the provision is they came and the Lord fed them and took care of them. And we know that God is going to supply our needs, our every need, through Jesus. And in Philippians 4:19 says this, "And my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus." Now, if that scripture said by your next door neighbor, you'd be hanging around your next door neighbor a lot. Because God, hey, God's told me you're going to supply all of my needs, okay? Or if the Lord, that scripture said by your banker, all right? I'm going to be hanging around my banker a lot. My God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory by your banker. It doesn't say that. By Christ Jesus. And that's why we need to have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, because he reverses the curse. He reverses the curse and lets us walk in the bounty of God's goodness and grace, the grace towards us. And James 1:17 lets us know every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. Everything that's good, Christmas morning, babies, apple pie, whatever you like, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above. A beautiful sunset. There were some beautiful sunsets in the last few days. And so it comes from God. And you know, when you walk into a grocery store, you know, everything in that grocery store comes from God. You walk the produce, you know. I mean, where did all those vegetables and salads and, you know, onions and celery and potatoes, where did all that come from? God. God created this genetic code, and you put this little seed in the ground, and it grows, okay? Which came first, the chicken or the egg? Well, a creator actually came first, okay? That solves that. You don't have any of that without the creator. But you go down the meat aisle, and all that fish or poultry or beef or pork, it came from God. Some farmer somewhere, maybe in Oklahoma, was raising beef or whatever. It came from God, and all the canned soup and all that. You see what I'm saying? We need to thank God when you just go into a grocery store and say, God, this all comes from you. Woohoo! You know, you can say that in Walmart, and I think you'd lost your mind. But this is all, hey, look at everybody. And even, you know what I'm saying? It all comes from God. So we need to thank him, because we're so blessed that somewhere somebody is growing whatever it is that's there in that store or making that. It comes from the elements that God created. And Jesus supplemented their catch with other fish. I do think that's interesting. He says, come and eat breakfast, okay? And he said, and bring some of your fish over here. It said he had some coals, and Jesus said, bring some of the fish which you had just caught. Let me pause here and just think about it. Jesus could have had all the fish and said, hey guys, breakfast is ready. Just come over here and eat. I've got all these fish. Or he could have had no fish at all and just said, guys, bring your fish over here. But he said, I already have some fish, but you bring some fish too. Do you see the cooperation there? That breakfast was a joint effort. And by the way, Jesus wasn't gluten-free. They were eating bread. And when everybody gets so gluten-free, I'm going, you know, Jesus ate bread. He created bread and fed the multitudes. So I don't know. Some people, because of their health issues, cannot eat bread. But I'm saying it can't be all that bad. Okay. Right, Lord? Okay, will you back me up on that? But what I think it was a lesson in evangelism, I think, because sometimes God uses us together in a cooperative, he orchestrates a cooperative effort, like the Ethiopian eunuch, Philip the evangelist. He said, hey, you need to go talk to this guy. He's reading the book of Isaiah. He doesn't understand it. So the Spirit and Philip, the Lord gets Philip going, and he goes there, and the guy gets saved. Or there's a guy like Cornelius, a Roman centurion. An angel appears to him, say, go get Peter. And so Peter comes in his cooperative effort, and Peter preaches the gospel, and he gets saved. But every now and then, the Lord just catches a fish all by himself. Saul, who became the Apostle Paul on the road to Damascus, he said, I'm just getting that one right now. Okay, I got him, because he's not going to believe anybody else. He's killing Christians left and right, think that he's serving me, and his actions are, You know, why are you persecuting me? And so sometimes just by a sovereign act of God, people are saved. And so to me, that's kind of a lesson on evangelism, of being a fisher of men. I don't know. My opinion, the Bible doesn't stress that. But you see that sometimes. Others are won by people witnessing to them and all of that. And the Lord works on their heart. And every now and then somebody just has experience. I mean, when I was called back to the Lord on October the 20th, 1978, Friday night, that was the Lord bringing me back. It wasn't anybody knocking on my door or calling me. The Lord got my attention and brought me back. And so sometimes the Lord does that. The Lord does that. I still think my grandma and my great-grandma were praying for me, okay? They were saying, you know, little Benny's kind of gone out there, okay? Little Benny is kind of messing up. And you need to reel him back in, God. And God did that. God did that. And their nets did not break as in the previous and similar incident recorded in Luke 5. And I would just say there, I believe that maybe talks of the sovereignty of election and the security of the believer. When God gets us, he gets us. And as you labor for the Lord, another is a thing that I think you may feel at times you are at the breaking point. In your life, sometimes you feel like you're at the breaking point. I just can't handle this. And we all get there. We all get there. Some of you may have felt like that today or this week. We just sometimes like, I cannot do this, Lord. But I'm going to trust in you. And if you will trust in him or rely on him, he'll hold you together. And you will not break. You will not fall apart. But sometimes you come right to that point where you don't know. Well, you finally say, I can't do this, God. You're going to have to step in and help me. You're going to have to step in. Amen? Some of you have been there. You know that. You know that. You know that. That's when you don't necessarily pray. You just cry out to the Lord. And then verses 15 through 25, when he's talking to Peter, and he said, do you love me? You know, tend my lambs, feed my sheep. Understanding the expectations of the risen Christ. The Lord sought out fellowship with the disciples and initiated the restoration of Peter. The Lord commanded that his sheep should be tended, fed, and shepherded. And the Lord expects us to follow him, even if our paths may drastically differ from other followers. He asked Peter three times. He said to him, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these? I think Jesus was referring to the disciples. John MacArthur, I read him a lot. He said he thought he was referring to the boat and the nets and the fish. Do you love me more than your past occupation? I kind of don't go there because I know that Peter, before he denied the Lord three times, he said, Lord, even if everyone else denies you, I will never deny you. I will stay with you, stand by you until death, no matter what. And he blew it. He denied the Lord three times. And so I think they're walking along the seashore and he said, do you love me more? Are you more special? Is your love more special than these other guys that are here, the other disciples? And he's basically, do you love me? And he said, Lord, you know that I love you. Now, there's two different words that are used here, and I'm going to bring it up briefly. One, we usually call it agape, but it's agapao, do you agapao, or agape me. That's calling about the supreme love. Peter says, you know that I phileo you. That means I have great affection for you. But it's not like the supreme love of agape or the verb agapao. And so I think the reason that Peter used this term, again, this is my opinion, but is that he felt shame. He said, do you have supreme love for me, Peter? He said, I have a great affection for you, Lord. He was ashamed because he'd said, oh, yes, Lord, I'm going to follow you no matter what. I'm going to be willing to give my life for you, even though all others forsake you. And he's like, I didn't live up to that standard, and I really hate to say, yes, Lord, I have supreme love for you. I think he was just ashamed because God used him in a mighty way. And, you know, at Pentecost and after that, he was basically the leader of the disciples. And so he uses a different verb, and I've heard that kind of twisted here and there, but the Lord asked him twice do you agapao me? Do you have supreme love for me? And he said, yes, I phileo you. And then the last time the Lord said, do you phileo me? Do you have a great affection or fondness for me? And he said, yes, Lord, I do. It is interesting that he said, feed my lambs, tend my sheep, and the three things that he said there, I have them written down here. But anyway, it's not, basically what he's saying is, if you love me, put your love into action and feed my sheep and tend my lambs and tend my sheep and shepherd them. That's what he was saying. You be a shepherd to my sheep. And so if we say we love God, it's going to be translated into action. And so Peter was to lead and to tend. And, you know, after we're saved, we need encouragement. We all need encouragement on a daily basis. We need a fellowship with the Lord. And so the Lord sought out the disciples for fellowship and to restore them. And when we fail, we need to get restored to the Lord ASAP, right? We need to say, we don't need to let it drag on and on. We need to say, Lord, forgive me. I repent, Lord. Help me. And the Lord commanded that his sheep should be attended and fed and shepherded. 1 John 1:3, I didn't read that scripture, but it says, that we have seen and heard, we declare to you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son Jesus Christ. And so, on the seashore, He desired to have fellowship with them. He desired to restore Peter's fellowship with Him, and that's what God wants us to have fellowship with Him. He wants us to walk with Him daily. And if you see something that's really cool, you can say, Lord, that is so cool. Thank you, God. That is amazing. If you see something, sometimes I just say that to the Lord. I think, Lord, I'll see something in nature or something. I'll say, that is so amazing, God. I don't know how you created that butterfly or that whatever, or that flower. And 1 Peter 5:2-4, Peter again says, shepherd the flock of God which is among you, okay? Now that he has been asked to shepherd, he is now telling other shepherds, shepherd the flock of God which is among you, serving as overseers, not by compulsion, but willingly, not for dishonest gain, but eagerly, not as being lords over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. He was preaching that to himself, and then he preached it to other pastors. And you know, that kind of gets my attention. And in some ways, it frightens me, because I realize that my job is to be an example to you guys. It's like, wow, Lord. I mean, really. I mean, one of my things is to do that, and to do it as a calling. Just do it as a calling, and not for any other ulterior motives. It's to say, it's a calling, and I am to shepherd, and I am to feed, and I am to preach doctrine, and I am to pray for you. And you know, that is a great responsibility, and sometimes I feel overwhelmed by it, and I just have to say, God, help me, because sometimes I don't feel sufficient for that great calling. But I know that you pray for me, and I appreciate it when y'all pray for me before I stand up here and preach. I appreciate that. And one thing about animals that you feed them, they need to... Well, my dad, we used to have some horses. We used to live on a ranch south of Carter, and Dad had these horses. And, you know, we are to feed the sheep, pastors, but the sheep need to come, or the horses need to come. And Dad, I can't whistle like I used to. Anybody have that trouble? But my dad used to have a real loud whistle, and those horses would be on the north of the barn, way up maybe hundreds of yards away, up on the gypsum hills, and Dad would have this whistle kind of go something like, I don't know, it's something like that. That wasn't very good. Sorry, Dad. And it was really loud, though, but it was like, woo, 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 woo. Anyway, and these horses would look, and about five or six of them would just come thundering down the hills, to get their feed. And he would throw out hay, or he would throw out some grain for them. And, you know, one of the frustrations, I think, of pastors is that you get a message already, and just think of I mean, there's so many people out there that say, oh, yeah, I'm a Christian, but they're malnourished. They never get to hear the Word of God. They don't get to worship. They don't get to fellowship with us. They say, oh, yeah, I'm a Christian, but, man, they're skin and bones, spiritually speaking, out there because they're not getting their nutrients. You understand? It's so I'm preaching to the choir. You're here this morning. I'm so glad. But we need to come and hear what God has to say to us. We need to come and look at the Word and fellowship with one another and worship Him. And thank you, Jared. You've done a great job this morning. I appreciate him so much. And continue to pray for Kisten and Levi as this baby is getting ready to come. And finally, the Lord expects us to follow Him even if our paths may drastically differ from our other followers. When they're walking along the seashore, basically Peter says, okay, and what about John back here? And he said, what is it to you if he stays alive until I come back? You follow me. And I know sometimes that, you know, we see other people's lives and they seem better than ours. Or like, well, God, why can't my life be like their life? I mean, or why can't my success be like their success? Or, you know what I'm saying? It's just like we're called to live our lives. We're called to live our lives. We each have a race to run and we have a lane to run in, and that is our ministry. And we are to fulfill our calling. You are to fulfill your calling. You can't fulfill my calling. I can't fulfill your calling. You can't fulfill the calling of the person sitting next to you, but you fulfill your calling. As you follow Christ, don't merely focus on yourself, your shortcomings and your limitations. At one time, Peter said, depart from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man. Don't look at the prevailing circumstances. Peter started looking at the water and the waves, and he began to sink when he was walking on water. And don't compare your station in life with other Christians. What about John? Follow the Lord, fulfill your ministry, trust in His goodness, and maximize your potential for the glory of God. Amen? That's what we're doing. You do that. Trust in His goodness. Maximize your full potential for the glory of God. Don't sell out. Don't sell yourself out. Don't sell yourself short. Say, God, I want to be used by you in the greatest way possible. Kind of scary. Kind of scary. But listen, it'll be awesome. It'll be awesome what God chooses to do in your life if you'll do that. You will live in a different dimension that a lot of Christians never find. You will live in that supernatural dimension where God's talking to you and walking with you and guiding you. And so I know we've gone through a lot of stuff this morning rather quickly, but the 21st chapter of John tells us a lot. Let me just close with a brief illustration, and I kind of hate to do it around Jared because he's a track star, but for a while in high school, I used to practice with the track team, and I wasn't that fast when I got to high school, and so they said, you're going to be long distance. And I remember we had to run around 4 miles, you know, and this is before I really got in shape, but we had to run around the section. And I remember coming back into the stadium after going, you know, 4 miles, and I remember my head. The coach said one thing to me. I was running like this, like, I am so tired. I am so tired. I just want to collapse, you know. And I remember, I really did. I just remember my head's just going like that. And the coach said afterwards, why do you throw your head from side to side? It's like, I'm tired, coach. He said, keep your head looking straight ahead. Keep looking at where you're running. Because I was just kind of going, I'm so tired. Keep looking ahead. You know what? Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Because if we focus on ourselves, yes, we're tired. Yes, we get weary. Yes, things happen that we don't understand. But if we look unto Jesus, He's the author and finisher of our faith, we will press towards that finish line. And I remember that finish line, you know, people were clapping, going, kick, kick. Do they still say kick? I don't know. Back then, that means finish good, finish fast. I know you're tired, but give it everything that you have towards the end. And they were cheering you on as you were coming in there, encouraging you. And the coach was standing right there going, all right, come on, come on, come on. Jesus is encouraging us. He's sitting right now at the right hand of God, making intercession for you and me. Isn't that awesome? He's saying, you can do it. I will provide what you need when you need it. I will be there with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Whatever burden you have this morning, whatever obstacle you're facing, you can do it with his help. Amen. Amen. Let's close in prayer and thank you, Jesus. Lord, we close this morning. We're out of time. There's so much there, Lord, in your word. But the main thing is, Lord, you restored Peter to the ministry that you had him in, had for him, and you used him in a great way. And Lord, he lost his self-confidence, but then he regained his confidence in you. Even though he forsook you and denied you, you never forsook nor denied him. And so thank you, Lord. We can apply that to each one of our lives. And as we conclude this morning, if there's someone here, I want to make this personal. We make this personal. If there's someone here, you are dealing with them, and you're saying to them this morning, follow me. Follow me. I have a plan for your life. I died on the cross for you to give you eternal life. I want you to spend eternity with me. I want to be your Lord and Savior here upon this earth and help you through the bad times, the difficult times. I want you to be an overcomer in this world. I want you to be someone that spreads the love, my love to others, and that sheds the light of my presence to others in a dark world. Lord, if you're speaking that to someone here this morning, you're saying, follow me, or someone on Facebook Live this morning, or watching on YouTube, Lord, I pray that they would accept you and say, yes, Lord, I will follow you. I will follow you this morning. I give my life to you. I turn from my former life and my sins, and I come to you in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, that if someone does that today, that they would walk an aisle, come up here and tell me they made that decision, or call our church and say, I made that while watching on Facebook or YouTube. And I pray this, Lord, in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Let's all stand. Would you prayerfully stand? If God wants you to make a public decision today, please do so. Please do so.
Take my life, lead me, Lord. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Make my life useful to thee. Take my life.
If you need
lead
to step out,
Lord.
You just step out. Don't be
Take
embarrassed.
My life,
don't be embarrassed.
Lead me, Lord. Make my life useful to thee. Take my life, teach me, Lord. Take my life, teach me, Lord. Make my life useful. Take my life, teach me, Lord. Take my life, teach me, Lord. Make my life useful.
Amen. It's been good to have been with you today. Again, thank you, Jared. Did a great job this morning. Pray for Kisten and Levi and little Sadie Ray. I think she'll be here next Sunday, and we'll probably get some, well, not here, but she'll be with us, and we'll get to see some pictures. We were going to have a staff meeting. I don't think we're going to have that. It didn't get in the bulletin, so we're not going to have it. We're going to do it next Sunday. Tonight, we're going to do a Robert Jeffress Bible study, Not All Roads Lead to Heaven. By the way, wear your Tulakes t-shirts next week, all right? We'll take credit, okay? The shirts are out there. If you can't pay for them, just put it in the plate next week. But the shirts are out there on the table, and let's all wear our shirts, and let's pray that God's going to help our church to meet this challenge. We have a financial challenge before us. Let's pray that God can help us to meet that, amen? He will. Okay, you are dismissed in the love of God. God bless you.